Hey, this is Max here. So Integromat evolved and changed their branding into MIG. So in this video, which they were also kind enough to sponsor, we're going to talk about why they made that change and what actually changed, because there's some pretty cool, nifty new features. So let's just dive right in. So why the change? Before I'm going to show you all these nifty features, let's just first talk a bit about why they changed from Integromat to MIG. So I've been a customer for 3 or 4 years of Integromat, and I got pretty used and attached to the name, and now they changed it to MIG. So why did they do that? So here on this page, which I will also link in the description below if you want to read this for yourself, basically what I'm reading here between the lines is this, that they realized that their platform is more than just integration and automation, because I guess that's how they came up with the name Integromat. And now they realize, like, hey, people are actually doing way more with this. Like, they're creating workflows, processes to backend systems and custom applications way more than just automations and integrations. And the name MIG, like, it's really short, right? Like, I quite like it. And they also say that here, like, it's short, modern, easy to spell and pronounce. And I guess that's also what the reason for this rebranding was, is that Integromat sounds maybe a bit techy, right? And I think MIG, that really sounds like something anybody could do, right? So that's a bit what I changed. And personally, so I used to study graphic design, like, I don't know, 12 years ago, 10 years ago. And I also pretty like their logo and also the reason behind it. Like, they have this domino symbol, right? And they explain here that this logo symbolizes a simple action that launches a sequence of events with endless possibilities and outcomes. And that's a bit what the scenario is, right? You trigger the scenario, and then what you can do with it, the possibilities are endless. So yeah, pretty cool. But let's now dive into what actually changed with MIG. So on their website, they have this big overview of everything that is new and that has been changed. So it's a very, very big list of features. I will not go over every single little thingy, but if you want to check it out, then just look at the link in the description below. So let's just start at the top. So new architecture. So I'm really not an expert in this, right? But they said now that MIG is hosted on the Amazon Web Services cloud platform, and it is built on a new foundation, which is supposed to be more performant and scalable. So I assume this is especially great if you're one of those power users that is using hundreds of thousands, maybe even millions of operations every single month. Then it is nice to know that MIG is very scalable with you, and that you then not after a certain time have to switch to a different platform which is more scalable. Now then, down here, another feature that I also thought was quite cool is that now everybody with a MIG account can create a template. So before, only Integromat employees, they could make templates. Now everybody can make templates, and you can share them privately with your team, or you can share them with other MIG teams and organizations via a public link. So I think that is pretty cool. They also improved something with the search. So you can now say, I want to look for example, here they say the Slack app, and then you can also give it the keyword. So then in this case, it's going to look for templates that have a Slack module, a Zendesk module, and that contain the word report. So it's supposed to make that a bit easier. Now then there's also Teams. So Teams is a really big new feature, because there was nothing like that inside Integromat before. So you had organizations, but you had nothing inside your organization to structure or organize who could access which scenario. So that's pretty cool right now. So you can create multiple teams inside your organization. So for example, here they have a sales team, a development team, a documentation team, a marketing team, a HR team. And then inside those teams, you also have different roles. Like, you have a team admin, a member, monitoring, operator, and a restricted member. And I think this is really pretty cool, because then you can, for example, say that the HR team, they can access all the HR scenarios, but they cannot touch by accidentally, for example, the scenarios that are really important for the sales. And it's also good to, like, separate your data to make sure that only people can access data to which they are allowed to have access. So that's also pretty good. So I think this is a really exciting feature if you work in a team. Now then, scenarios, they changed quite a lot of things in the scenarios, not huge things. The scenarios still operate in the same way, I would say, but there are some small nifty new features that I really like. For example, there is the scenario execution history full text search. So first I was like, okay, that's really like not necessary. But actually last week I had something in my scenario, something went wrong. I got a notification that something went wrong. And then I was like, okay, I need this customer ID, but on which scenario execution is this? And then right now I could just use this full text search for that customer ID, and boom, the right scenario execution came up. So I actually think this is a pretty cool new feature. Now, then there is also this live streaming of scenario executions. So if you want, you can just take a look at your scenarios and you can just see like, it's automating for me. So that's quite nice. I'm not exactly sure why that would be useful for me, but I think it's probably good to see like, hey, it's running. So many things are running at once. So here they also show you how that looks like. So here you have the history and then here things that are currently running. Now, then over here, they also have your scenario execution history. And then they say here, show check runs. So you have this thing here in the top. And this is actually really handy because you have some scheduled scenarios. Imagine you have something that is going to check your inbox every 15 minutes to see if you have a new email. And then let's say that, I don't know, you only get a few emails a day. So then you see all these check runs, like check. Nothing was found. And then suddenly the 60th check an email was found. So then first you had like a list here of all these check runs. And then you really had to search for the execution. So right now you can just say, no, I do not want to see the check runs. And then you only see the actual executions where some new data was found. In this case, for example, a new email. So I think this is a handy new little feature. Now, then they also improved something with the experience or the performance of looking for the execution. So you have here an execution, and then first they said here that it was first getting a bit sluggish in performance if there was a large amount of data, and right now they fixed that. Personally, I never experienced this, but if you experienced that, then hey, cool to know that now they fixed that, right? Now then, webhooks. So I think webhooks is a really big part of Make and also was of Integromat, because that's a way of data getting into Make and starting your scenarios. And right now, what they said, it is possible to have parallel webhooks. So for then explain here that Integromat webhooks first were processed sequentially, for that a really difficult word, sequentially, and then executions were queued to wait for the first one to finish for the next one to start. And in Make, you can have multiple executions that can basically run parallelly with each other. So here you also see an example with that. So here you see that live streaming of your scenario basically, right? And then you see here that three executions are running at the same time. So I think that's pretty cool that that is possible, especially important if you want your execution and data to be processed as fast as possible. So I never really had that urge that I really wanted it to go as fast as possible, but I can totally see why this can be handy in some cases. Now, then webhook list shows scenarios that each webhook is related to. So first it looked like this, right? Then you had like your list of webhooks. And then here it just would just say like, okay, it's on or off. And then how many things are in the queue of that. But you cannot so easily find where or in which scenario this webhook was used. So that was a bit of an issue. And right now they improved this. So each webhook can only be used in one scenario. And then what you see is this. So you see your webhooks. And then over here you have these buttons next to those webhooks so that you can just easily find to which scenario that webhook belongs to. So I really like that. I really think that's cool. First, I was a bit like, oh man, I have to change all my scenarios, how I set them up, because I was just having one webhook. I used it for multiple scenarios. So there was a little bit of a pain to change that. But now I actually like this change. I'm like, okay, this actually makes sense. It's just easier to manage your scenarios this way. Now then webhook queue list improvements. So this is a really small little thingy, but first you had a queue list. The queue list looked like this. And then if you wanted to delete something in the queue list, you had to press the bin or press delete all. And then right now you can just check here and select multiple things that then you want to delete the selected. Now, very small little thingy, not super exciting. Now then let's see what else they have that I think is really cool. So here, the time savers. I really, really like this. This was also when I first started using Make, when I made the switch, when I migrated over to Make. This was the first first thing that I also noticed, beside all the purple pink branding, right, is the new forms interface. So there are some changes here. So right now, when you open a module, you have all these drop downs inside your little model windows. So here, if I go over to any of my scenarios, let's just do that and I can just show it. That, for example, I have over here generating a completion certificate. And then if I, for example, go over here to this module, then you see right now that we have all these drop downs here. So you can easily only show the relevant information inside this module. So it just makes it a little bit easier to have that overview. And then also in some things, you can then also search in like a list. So here, for example, I can here type share, and then here you see that this one shared with me, Google Shared Drive shows up. So in this case, it's just like a three-point list. So it doesn't make so much sense, but sometimes you have like really long lists. And then it's nice that you can search in that. So another thing that I really like. Now then, improved data store browser interface. So this is about the data stores, right? So over here, if you go over here, you have the data stores. And then you see, for example, here, I don't know, appointments. So first, this would open in a new pop-up window. And right now it just opens inside the same window. And I also made some small changes of how this looks and how you can change this data. So another nice little feature, right? And then this one for me, I think this is maybe my favorite change, is that you can use the functions a little bit more easy. I, for example, have this scenario over here. And then you can see over here that I, for example, sometimes have modules that have like a crazy amount of these functions, right? And first, there was no way to tell really where that function would end and where it would start. You really kind of had to guess and really look like, okay, you have this. Okay, this is supposed to be a look here. And now you can just hover this, like I hover this, and then you see this line showing up underneath. You see it like showing up here, and here. And also if I do it here, then you see that, okay, this belongs here. I think that's really handy. And also if you break something, so now I broke something, and then you see also that the red line shows up underneath, so that you know like, hey, something is wrong inside this function formula, basically. So for me, this is really, really handy new feature. It's so simple, but I really, really like it. Here they also give you a little example over here of how you can do this. So yeah, these are basically all the most important changes in Make. So I'm super curious what you think about it. Let me know in the comments below, and also let me know if you have any questions over there. And if you do not have a Make account yet, then you can use my link in the description below, and then you get 1 month of their pro plan for free. And if you want to learn everything about Make, then I have a really cool beginner's tutorial over here that you can check out. So see you in the next one.